Hello, welcome to Introduction Philosophy. I'm Grant Yoakum. I'll be your instructor for this semester for this online course, Introduction to Philosophy, Phil 101, Section 7, CRN 41885. This is fall 2015, and I've already detected my first typo on the course syllabus. It's an online OLAS, apparently that should read class. I've corrected it in my copy, but yours is probably still messed up on Moodle. So I'm Grant Yoakum. The first things you find on the syllabus, it's basically this video is to introduce myself and to go over the syllabus. Is my name, my email address, yoakum@oakland.edu, which you can grab off Moodle just very quickly and easily. And a stipulation about office hours, Monday and Wednesdays by appointment. I suppose I should start off by telling you a little bit about who I am. And I suppose I should start off by saying, first off, I'm complicated. The first thing is, I'm teaching and have been teaching a lot of these online classes because I'm in Canada. Right. This is my new office, which you can tell I'm not even really moved into yet. Some of the videos for this class will be here. I also have a little studio set up with a chalkboard, which if I need visuals or anything along those lines, that will be handy for that. So I'm in Canada. I've been commuting to Oakland University, which is complicated after 9/11. Since winter 2005. So I'm just completing my 11th year. 10th? 11th? I'm not a mathematician. So anyhow, I have not fallen off the turnip truck. I've been doing this for quite some time, teaching Introduction to Philosophy, Introduction to Ethics, and the odd upper level class as well. I've taught for Oakland University. I've taught for University of Detroit Mercy. I've taught for University of Michigan Dearborn. I've taught for Oakland Community College. I've taught for University of Windsor and Brock University on this side of the border as well in Canada. I have two undergraduate degrees, one of which an honors in philosophy, master's in philosophy, and I'm currently completing a PhD. My credentials are PhD ABD, so it's just the dissertation, which overlaps with some of the class material between me and the moniker doctor. So, I'm well trained in all of this, this should be hopefully an interesting course. So the other complication is I recently became father to twins, which might explain, at least in part, the office hours by appointment only. Childcare responsibilities being what they are, and students accessing on-campus office hours. I find students generally don't come unless there is an assignment due or there's some sort of course-related question or problem. So I would be more than happy on Mondays and Wednesdays to meet with you on campus. These are the days that I'm teaching on campus. I have a 3:30 class, and Wednesday nights I have a night class. So either before or after those classes, preferably before the night class, I'd be happy to meet with you by appointment. I'm sure we can set something up. It's just a matter of hitting the road a little bit early for me. You can find my office in room 319 O'Dowd Hall, which is, for the time being, where the Department of Philosophy is. I've heard we're moving. I don't have all the details on that yet. But nonetheless, it's the old office shared by, I think we're up to 7 of us, who are special lecturers for the department that all sort of negotiate time in that office. If that office is taken, we can find someplace else on campus to meet. And if you absolutely cannot make Mondays or Wednesdays, I'd be happy to book a Skype meeting with you. This being an online class, I understand a number of you are away from campus yourself and have interesting responsibilities that take you away from your otherwise on-campus education. So it's partially working around my schedule and partially working around your schedule. This course meets virtually, so it will be videos uploaded to YouTube like this one here that most of your class instruction will come from. I supplement these videos by including other video and audio content that I find interesting and relevant to the course material. So please stay up with that. It's the additional content will be from either radio broadcasts or other philosophers doing the sorts of things that I'm doing, usually with much higher production values than I've got. This is just a webcam on my laptop that I do everything with. Right? I don't exactly have a budget for this sort of thing, so no star wipes or anything along those lines. So anyhow, so please stay up to date. The supplements, I frequently test on those supplements in addition to the video content that I provide. And a word of advice, contact me via email or in person with any and all course difficulties. Don't let these things go and then try to address them later. It's better to stay up to date with these classes, because even in a full semester, these courses tend to really fly. So the next thing you'll come across on your syllabus, that's strange with the lighting there, is the course catalog description. There are a couple of important sort of elements to this. The first off is that it's a study of the main types of problems in Western philosophy. So I'll be using a historical introduction starting with the next video, which is on the pre-Socratics. And moving through Socrates to Plato to Aristotle, a brief sojourn in early modern philosophy with the political philosophy of Thomas Hobbes, and then to the sort of pre-existential philosophers Kierkegaard and Nietzsche. Hopefully, by means of this historical introduction, we'll be able to address various problems within the three main fields of philosophy, which are epistemology, metaphysics, and ethics. The next video will explain this. So readings are chosen to illustrate the development of Western thought from the ancient Greeks, which I'm doing, to present. And as present as we're getting is about 130 years ago, which, interesting for philosophers, is almost like yesterday. So, nonetheless, that's definitely what we'll be doing here, historical introduction. Basically, I'd be trying to build sort of a conceptual arc centered around a couple of themes for the course, right? Which I'll go into in a moment. The other thing that we have to do is sort of develop your ability and facility with language in terms of using language very precisely. This is one of the things that philosophy does. It uses language very precisely to convey something basic about the human condition or experience, or about human reality, as bad translations of Heidegger or Simone de Beauvoir actually call it. But nonetheless, right? So this is going to be a language intensive course, and in the context that we're in right now, it's going to be a writing intensive course. So I'll go into exactly how we're going to accomplish language and writing intensivity, word? Yeah, I think so, in a moment. But nonetheless, so this class satisfies the general education requirement in Western Civ, the knowledge exploration area, and like I say, I've been teaching it for better than a decade now. So, your textbooks, there are a lot of them, and I've tried to order as cheaply and as effectively as possible. There was a little bit of a wait because I was behind over the summer with the sort of twin sort of baby bomb that sort of exploded in my life last February. We were a little while in the NICU, and things are just starting to normalize now. So I was a little bit late on ordering the textbooks, but these are ones that I've used for a number of semesters. There should be tons and tons and tons of used copies out there. Various other booksellers, in addition to the university bookstore, I've checked, they are on hand. But other bookstores and sellers online, in addition to the university bookstore, should have really cost-effective versions of these books. Every time I walk into a used bookstore, I see basically all of the textbooks for my class sitting there for $3-$4 or something like that, with one exception. So the first book that we will be engaging with is Plato's Five Dialogues. Like I say, there are a lot of these books, and that's probably freaked you out, but this is a silly little pamphlet of a book with, well, five dialogues in it. And we will be taking a look at two of those five dialogues. Plato's Five Dialogues, we're relying on that for Socrates. So I'm one of these people that makes the distinction between Socrates and Plato. It relies on his early material rather than his later material. For the Socrates moniker, there's some dispute over this, but nonetheless, some argue that Socrates, we get his position more or less accurately through the reportage of Plato's early work. By about the middle period, the last dialogue in the five dialogues, the Phaedo, what we find is Plato trying to interject some of his theory into reportage of Socrates' position. And then in the later work, we get full-blown Plato. And you'll see there are very, very distinct positions being offered. Some others like to argue that that's because a theorist, their theories develop through time, right? But nonetheless, I make the distinction. It's a historical distinction. Some of the bean counters in the history of philosophy might call question to it, but nonetheless, there was a historic figure by the name of Socrates who went to trial in Athens for corrupting the youth and not believing in the gods of the state. And we will be starting with the Apology, which is basically his trial defense, right? And then an argument following that trial defense in the Credo. They're related to one another in interesting and useful ways, I think. So we'll start off by taking a look at two of those dialogues. Then we will move to Plato's Phaedrus. I've been teaching this book for quite some time, and we will be taking a look at just the first 49 pages. And what is it, 94? So that's a little bit better than half the book, but nonetheless, the subject of this book is love, actually. Is it better to have a casual relationship with all of the implications you might think about a casual relationship? Or to fall in love is the major problematic of the first three speeches in this book. Ultimately, the argument in the Phaedrus is about rhetoric, right? The use of persuasive argumentation. But nonetheless, it's what I'm interested in Plato's argument here. Three arguments here is it basically where he thrashes out the basics of his metaphysics, epistemology, and ethics, right? Metaphysics, the theory of the underlying nature of truth or reality. Epistemology, a theory of knowledge. Ethics, a theory of action, right? And oddly, this book, all three come out. There is another book that I could have used. Where are you here? Okay. Here we go. Why not? It is in the Great Dialogues of Plato, and this particular book has The Republic. Now, I would, in order to get the same amount of, or the same theoretical positions out of The Republic, we would have to read nearly 350 pages. So it's that much of a book versus that much of half of that even. And so that's why I use the Phaedrus. Plus, it's kind of a fun, amusing. I think Plato is trying to be funny in this one. So that is going to be the second book that we're taking a look at. Both of these I've seen used for 2, 3, 4, less than that, kind of sometimes, right? Go on $8 and you might find $2.50. The shipping is where they get you there. So that's the first two theorists. That's the first third of the class. We're actually studying 6 theorists in total. After Plato and Aristotle, or not Plato and Aristotle, Socrates and Plato, we move to Aristotle, or as it's more properly pronounced, Aristoteus, and his Nicomachean Ethics. How this works is Socrates was the mentor of Plato. Plato established the first university in the Western world, just called the Academy. We're all called academics these days because Plato called his first university the Academy. Well, the star pupil at the Academy was Aristotle. He was the student of Plato, but he and Plato disagreed in a very, very important metaphysical respect, which I'll go into here. But in addition to that, when Plato retired from the Academy, he appointed a different student, not his star pupil Aristotle, to be director of the Academy. So Aristotle started his own alternate university called the Lyceum. Right? And in the Lyceum, basically, we get a series of student notes, which is all we know of Aristotle, thanks to Christians sacking ancient libraries, specifically the Library of Alexandria. Much of Aristotle was lost for a long time and then found its way back into circulation and ultimately popularity through Islamic philosophers and sort of Islamic archaeology, and then popularized through the late medievals, right? Avicenna and ultimately St. Thomas Aquinas. So essentially what we have from the Nicomachean Ethics is a series of lecture notes, like your lecture notes on my lectures would be about the quality of what we have, but nonetheless a series of lecture notes that are edited into consistent arguments, right? In the Nicomachean Ethics, the object of the question is happiness, right? So we will be defining and seeing what the consequences of a definition of happiness are, along with Aristotle, which he believes can ground in ethics. He also named the book after a child, his nephew Nicomachus, which tells you that it's at least part of child rearing manual as well. Right. Then we jump about 1,500 years into the future to the early modern period with the political philosopher Thomas Hobbes and his Leviathan. I do this because, well, it's only one course and I'm trying to sketch an arc and a hard distinction between the ancients and the moderns. Interestingly, for a long time, very little happened in terms of philosophy, in terms of new systems of philosophy being produced and argued. For a long time, it was largely Christian appropriations of Plato and then much later Aristotle that actually defined the discipline. Not to say that the medieval philosophers weren't brilliant and nuanced and important in a lot of respects, but nonetheless, largely what they were doing is fleshing out the consequences in a Christian context of Plato and Aristotle in Western philosophy. So this is one of the reasons, I'll go into more of them, that I am hopping ahead to Thomas Hobbes, who explores basically the nature of political power. What he wants to do is do sort of an anatomy of a sovereign state, right? So Just to recap, what we get from Plato's first couple of dialogues is a treatment of, let's be sloppy here, justice. Right? Then we talk about love. Then we talk about happiness. Then we talk about power. Right? And it may not look like this book is well thumbed, but that's because I've recently ordered a new copy of it myself, because my old copy is actually falling apart for how much I've read it. This is one of the books that I can quote from memory with page references from the history of Western philosophy. It's that important an argument. People at poli-sci conferences are still talking about Hobbes' Leviathan. So, nonetheless, that is what we will be exploring there. Hobbes starts from an empiricist position. Largely the senses and the sensate are the ground of knowledge, and establishes through his empiricism sort of the nature of a political state based on the desires of man and the notion of a social contract, right? So we can look forward to that. Right. So I like to point out to, or I have pointed out to students in the past, puppy dogs and ice creams, justice, love, and happiness. Then we switch to political power. Right. Then we turn to a fellow by the name of Soren Kierkegaard. And what am I doing this semester? It's sickness unto death, isn't it? I'm having you buy this big honkin' book for one very short section, right? So I'm gonna pause here. So starting on page 350 and going to probably about 30 pages later, let me see, 372. So actually 22 pages later. This is how much of this book that we'll be taking a look at. I picked this because I really like this translation. There are online versions of this that are out there, and this is probably the most expensive book that I've had you purchase too. But I find this an excellent book. I find this the best translation that's out there. The Hongs do a really good job. I've been using this book because I like to jump around too. So I may give you a chunk of Fear and Trembling or the concept of anxiety or something along those lines to help me illustrate what I'm talking about here. So that's why I order this for you to elect purchase. These are all required textbooks. You got to read the material that I've assigned, right? But how you work around that, that's another thing altogether. Every now and again, if you do a Google search for the Essential Kierkegaard Hong and Hong PDF, you might actually get somebody who scanned the bloody thing for you. I don't know. That's none of my business. I've ordered this book because I like this translation. Anyhow, and it's an abridged version of Sickness Unto Death, too. So you'll get a rather long version of Sickness Unto Death if you grab it online. So Kierkegaard is, like I say, sort of a pre-existentialist or a proto-existentialist. These people start from human existence and human experience in order to make their arguments, rather than Hobbes, who starts with the senses, rather than Plato and Aristotle, who are logocentric. And Kierkegaard considers himself to be sort of a reformulation of Socrates. So you'll find in the section of Sickness Unto Death reference to Socrates and the Socratic concept of, in terms of what he's arguing there, sin, right? We're gonna linger quite some time on a very short amount of Kierkegaard because he's a difficult philosopher to wrap your head around. So it's in all of these cases, it's going to be depth of understanding rather than breadth of reading that we are aiming for. And you can see how whooped my copy is, but this is the Portable Nietzsche, where we will be reading Twilight of the Idols. This, or how one philosophizes with a hammer. to conclude the course. My own work actually engages with Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, and to some extent political philosophy through Hobbes as well. So that should be the interesting part of the course with regard to my research, though I absolutely love the ancient philosophers as well. There was an optimism there that's sort of been beaten out through the modern period of philosophy, if you ask me. So so those are your textbooks. There are tons. This is Penguin, so there are tons of copies of this that are fairly dirt cheap. In fact, I should get a new one because this one's almost becoming as bad as my Hobbes book. It's held together by packing tape at the spine. So those are your textbooks for the course. And like I say, I checked with the bookstore, and they are all in. I don't know if they ordered enough, but nonetheless, the last time I looked, they were there. So the conceptual arc that I'm going to be building has to do with the underlying nature of the human being, right? And how we mobilize desire and action, right? So it's human nature and to some extent ethics, right? In terms of making meaningful choices, living a meaningful life, right? So that's more or less the theme that I'm exploring. I wrote a little course description on your syllabus here, which I'll just quickly read. With philosophy, human beings attempt to define and understand their place in the world by asking the questions, what does it mean to be human? How do we come to terms with the world that we live in? How do we know how we ought to act? How ought we act? It's awkward, right? Etc. Philosophies attempt to develop a view of the world that allows them to act in the world and for that action to have meaning. In this course, we'll examine six philosophical accounts of human reality, focusing on their account of what it means to be human and for human action to be meaningful. From this vantage point, we will develop an understanding of philosophical and argumentative methods of questioning that serve to help people make sense of their lives daily, as well as explore a number of issues central to traditional philosophical dialogue. Now, I don't treat any one of these accounts as authoritative or bang on right. What I hope you will do as you cut your teeth with these difficult books, with these difficult theoretical positions, is to enable you to, you know, discharge your own intellectual resources to make sense of your lives. Right. So each of these philosophers, I think, have some important insights. Right. The other thing that I'm doing is sketching out sort of a gestured version of the history of Western philosophy for you to follow and understand in case you take further philosophy classes. And I would recommend that. So I'm not trying to persuade anybody to believe as any of these theorists believes. But what I am trying to do as your instructor is present as compelling a case for each of these positions as possible. Now, a word about me. If I do this right, you'll never, never figure out where I stand on any of these issues. That's not my role. Right. So it's not one of those classes where you have to please the professor, you have to write arguments that are believable by me, right? But rather it's one of those that it's just largely it's the rational weight and clarity and completeness of your argument. So that's when, and do you understand what the heck is going on, even if you don't buy what these theorists are claiming? There are some of these theorists that I don't buy what they're claiming, but nonetheless, the arguments have a certain importance and beauty to them, right? So that's why we're studying them. So how are you going to be assessed, right? I'm going to be jumping around a bit on the syllabus here, but at the bottom of the first page, You have a breakdown of how you're going to be assessed. Note that this adds up to 100%. So when I assign grades for these, what I'm going to do is, like the quizzes will be out of 10 points because each is worth 10%. And you'll be able to do the simplest of simple math to figure out exactly where you stand in the course. So first there are section quizzes, right? So each of these theorists, I describe all of these over on page 2 to 3. The course is divided into 6 sections. Each of the quizzes for this course will test only the section that we're working on. That is, they won't be comprehensive. Each quiz will consist of questions totaling to 10 possible points, typically 5 short answer questions, asking you to like define a term and then make an important distinction related to a particular philosopher. Questions will be designed to test both reading comprehension and a general understanding of the ideas that we've studied in class. So for these quizzes, everything is on tap for them. So these video lectures, the supplementary material that I assigned, I sometimes just present you with a passage and try to get you to sketch or interpret an argument or a distinction that the philosopher in question is making. Sometimes I ask you, here's a claim by this philosopher. What does this philosopher make this claim, etc., etc. So the readings, the video material, all of the supplementary material are on tap for these quizzes. These quizzes will be posted to Moodle on the Thursday, ending each section covered by the quiz. You will have until the end of the weekend, Sundays by 5 p.m., to submit your responses. The due dates are for these assignments are indicated on the syllabus. I'll get to those once we get to the class schedule. So that's the quizzes. These are pretty substantial quizzes. The nature of the material makes them sort of difficult because these theorists are using language and they're trying to in a very, very precise kind of way. The theorists themselves are hard to read. They're not trying to be difficult. I'm not trying to be difficult, but nonetheless, we're trying to be very precise with something, and it's going to require you to be very precise in your responses as well. So reading these questions very carefully and thinking very carefully about how you formulate your short answer responses, that's going to be key for this class. And discussion forum. Each of the theorists is going to be accompanied by a discussion forum topic. So I'm going to start off with Socrates and present you an issue that was raised by Socrates either in one of the videos or in the text itself, and ask you a specific directed question. Now, you're expected to engage in each of these forum discussions. The idea with the forum is that it's supposed to provide sort of you an opportunity to, because this is sort of mono-directional. It's, I record these videos, you might have a question, you can pause the video and send me an email, but you don't much get a chance to interact with your fellow students in the class. The discussion forums are supposed to provide a study resource, a rough workspace where you can work out your ideas. I grade them. I weight these discussion forums at 15% of your final grade. So this is the participation portion of your grade. So I've got rather a long description of these discussion forums. I already said that. They're expected to enter debates, offer criticisms, and generally discuss the nuances of the theoretical positions of each of these figures via this Moodle forum. So yes, you have to do them all. At the end of the semester, a grade out of 15 points will be assigned based on the frequency, relevance, and quality of your participation. All right, so I just gave you my grading criteria there. For example, posts like "I agree" or "this is stupid" without additional comments will be insufficient to garner a passing grade. I note here it's perfectly acceptable if your post is a response to another student. It's also perfectly acceptable to ask questions about the sections of the readings or more opaque nuances of the positions that we're studying. Illustrative examples are bang on. You've got an example in your mind that perfectly illustrates something that you've read or something that pertains to the discussion. That's a great way to engage with these. Or these illustrations either clarify or call question to the arguments of the specific figure. Generally, the idea here is to enhance your understanding of the course material, and for this to really work well, you all have to participate, and it's got to be a running conversation. Right? I ask myself three questions when I assign grades for this forum. One, have you posted at least once for each topic? More is better. The idea here is to foster the ongoing conversation about the issues raised by the material at hand. Now, I've just given you a minimum there. And the funny things about minimums is that if you do the minimum, your reward will be minimum as well. Right? So you do the minimum, I give you minimal grades. Right? So I'm telling you how to get a better pass here. Right. Secondly, are the posts substantial, or do the posts offer show engagement with the material? Every semester, I have posts that through which it's kind of clear that the student hasn't read the material or engaged with the material, right? Or read the other posts and responded in a thoughtful kind of way. I get very short, like one-liner responses kind of thing, and that's not a substantial engagement with the activity here, right? So these forums require a bit of substance, right? And then finally, are the posts timely? Which brings me to an interesting feature of these forums, right? Are the posts timely, or did the student wait until the last minute to do them all? Interesting feature about these forums, they are there so that you've got control of this 15% of your final grade rate up until the 9th hour, right? Or the 11th hour kind of thing. So I leave these forums open for the entire semester. So on December, when does this class end? 14th by 11:55 p.m., 5 minutes to midnight, the Socrates Forum is still going to be open. Right? You'll still have access to every bloody one of those. Right? So if you're worried about your grade come the end of the class, engage further in these forums. And since the next thing I'm about to get to here is a writing assignment, since there is a writing assignment, these forums are a great way to workshop your paper ideas and work out some of the nuances of the theory for the entire class, right? Right up until the last minute. There are pedagogical reasons for doing this. And like I say, both Nietzsche and Kierkegaard way at the end of the class are engaged with Socrates way at the beginning of the class. Everybody is in dialogue with everybody. So you may hit a point right at the end of the class where you'll say, oh wait, this makes sense for the Socrates or Plato or Aristotle forum, right? So I leave you access to that. The benefit for you is that 15% is just up in the air right up until the end. That said, I notice if all of your posts come in at 11 p.m. on December 14th. I notice. So that what that means is that all semester you've not been participating in and helping to generate the ongoing conversation and workshop with this material. That is the point of this material. I've also got a policy with regard to the discussion forums. Keep in mind, this is an academic resource, right? This is to enhance your understanding of the material. So general questions like, when are we getting our grades back? Or what's everybody doing on the weekend? Those are not for these forums. Posts like that will be removed. The other thing is, conduct policies come into play here too. Each of these theorists will be trying to talk about something very, very basic and close to you as a human being. So I anticipate that, of course, you're going to get hot under the collar. Some of these arguments are specifically designed to piss you off, specifically those made by Nietzsche. Right? They're designed for that. Right? Hobbes is going to get you hot under the collar. Right? Plato is going to tell you how to fall in love. Aristotle is going to tell you how to be happy. Right? And a lot of these theorists, and I've picked an interesting grab bag of them here that don't agree with one another, are going to challenge your basic precepts. Now, on the forums, as you're working out and hashing through in a fairly public way with this material, it's likely that somebody will post something that you disagree strongly with, or that questions something fundamental about how you live your lives or structure your theory of value. Aim your criticisms at the material and never at the person. Anything construed as a personal attack will be removed, and I'll issue some sort of a steep penalty. If the case is bad enough, in some cases, it's got to go before the Dean of Students office, right? So just keep it classy, keep it on target, right? That's all I'm asking with these discussion forums. For the writing project, right, for the last thing that you're going to be doing is writing a 1,000 to 1,250 word reflection paper directed towards a choice between three course overview questions. I formulate these questions throughout the semester based on what I read from the forums, based on what I'm thinking about with regard to the material, that sort of thing, based on my in-class discussions with my on-campus classes. I try to come up with three interesting, timely, unique kinds of questions that I keep, you know, deliberately general, so that you can engage with them yourselves. The questions for the writing project will be posted midway through the semester as I formulate them and as I get to know you and what you might be interested in. It's important that you take something from this class. So this will be due in lieu of a final exam on December 14th at 11:55 p.m. So it's going to be a reflection paper. Right, which is going to have you engage with a particular theorist or pair of theorists, right? So more on that will come out midway through the semester as I get a clear idea of what the questions are going to be. Sometimes I require that you issue a criticism of the philosopher in question. That will be worth 20% of your final grade, which I've tagged to a writing project proposal form as well. This proposal forum closes a little bit earlier. It closes the last day of class, which is when? December 7th, right? So it closes a week before the other forums and is designed to get you thinking about this assignment early, rather than pulling an all-nighter and just typing at a page until you have the right length. Right. So what I'm hoping for with the proposal is a substantial argument plan so that you can sort of plan how you're going to structure your ideas. Right. I've made that worth 5% of your final grade. There's a qualitative measure with it as well. And then there's a final writing project. All right. So how do your grades break down? 10% for each quiz, total of 60%. Discussion forum for another 15. We're up to, 75%, 5% for the writing project proposal. So we're up to 80%, and then 20 for the final writing project. It should be straightforward. And as your grades come in, you can see exactly how you're piling up grades towards your final grade, which is out of 100, right? It's out of 100%, so there are 100 points. So I've got a whole series of general policies here that are each here because I've had some sort of a big problem in the past in these classes, right? The policy section is growing in my syllabus. It seems like I've got to add new policies as I have new problems arise semester to semester. I'm a big believer in solving a problem before it becomes a problem. So if I see it coming, it's good to have a policy. You know where you stand. I know where I stand. There's something to refer to. And away we go. First policy is plagiarism. The first time I taught any philosophy course, I had a whole series of plagiarists, and it just blew my mind. Because the goal of philosophy is to develop, hone, an understanding of something specifically directed at making your life better. Right? So cheating at that is, it's in the deepest possible sense, self-defeating. Right? We'll get into notions of self that defeat themselves as we work through this course material. But nonetheless, the first thing I do is quote the Oakland University policy on plagiarism that you're responsible from the student handbook. And you'll note that I've got a footnote there telling you where it comes from. So plagiarizing the work of others, right? I read this on every welcome video and on the first day of every bloody class. Right? It takes time, but it's better to finger wag now and not have to later in front of the dean of students' office. Plagiarizing the work of others. Plagiarism is using someone else's work or ideas without giving that person credit. By doing this, a student is, in effect, claiming credit for someone else's thinking. Whether the student has read or heard the information used, the student must document the source of the information. When dealing with written sources, a clear distinction should be made between quotations, which reproduce the information from the source word for word within quotation marks, and paraphrases, which digest the source of the information and produce it in the student's own words. Both direct quotations and paraphrases must be documented. Even if a student rephrases, condenses, or selects from another person's work, the ideas are still the other person's, and failure to give credit constitutes misrepresentation of the student's actual work and plagiarism of another's ideas. Buying a paper or using information from the World Wide Web or Internet, redundancy there, without attribution and handing it in as one's own work is plagiarism. Now, like I say, the first time I taught these courses, I was inundated by cases of plagiarism. Just at Oakland University, I was doing this math for job application just recently. I've had 40 some odd, I forget the number anyway, 40 some odd, almost 50 cases before the Dean of Students of academic misconduct since I've started teaching at Oakland, which is high, right? It's high. Don't do it. It doesn't end well. I've got a zero tolerance policy on plagiarism for this course, right? The interesting thing about my contract is the university considers me an adequate judge of your understanding based on your written work, but they don't consider me an adequate judge of authorship. So if a question of authorship arises, I'm contractually obligated to pass the case on to an academic review board through the Dean of Students office. It's just what my contract tells me to do. And as soon as authorship is in question, my hands are tied. I need this job, so I need to follow the procedure. I need to do exactly what I'm told, right? That's just automatic. So, automatically passed on to an academic review board. Expulsion from the university is possible, right? Any number of sanctions, academic probation, suspension. In some cases, if you're caught doing this, they'll suspend you for the current semester, which wipes off, let's say you're taking five courses, it wipes out those five grades. How much do you pay for a course? I think it's over $1,000. So that's a pretty hefty fine for this kind of offense. Right? I like Oakland because they try to retain you and work with you as a student in each of their, but nonetheless, there's a punitive element of this. And for my part, you fail the course, not just the assignment. If you plagiarize by cutting and pasting or failing to attribute, that sort of thing, you just fail the course. You know, and for an assignment where 20% of your final grade, I've had students in the Dean of Students office have this aha moment right at the end of the course. So if I'd just written something and gotten a C, I would have been better off. Yes. Yes, if you've just done what you're supposed to do. Now, I'm going to pause quickly here and say that I don't know any of you. You're new. We've never spoken. We've never met. You haven't submitted any work. I don't know how you are as theorists. You haven't done anything yet, right? And this big honking policy on plagiarism puts me in a position where I'm finger wagging and treating you like criminals, even though you haven't done anything. This is my least favorite part of introducing a course, and it's my least favorite part of my job, right? So understand what plagiarism is, and in fact, if you're worried about it, I give you a reference to a link to an online program that you can take through the library. I've taken it. It's useful, which is called CiteWrite. It's through the Academic Writing Center. You get it for free automatically as students of Oakland. Just go through it. It's an online course. It'll tell you exactly how to properly reference your material and under what circumstances you have to reference. There's the resource there for you. It doesn't even take that long for the little program. There's a more intensive one that you can take through the Academic Writing Center if you're very interested in this. Very useful, very good. It's there so that you can avoid me doing this, right? Because I don't want to do that. You don't want me to do that. We all want to have a nice semester, and we all want to understand these ideas because they're human ideas, right? So that's the first policy. Second policy, missed assignment policy. I'm the first to understand that sometimes the sky just falls. Sometimes life happens, right? Last winter, very prematurely, my two twin daughters were born, and I had to do some fancy footwork to get through a semester. I get it. Everybody was generous. Everybody worked with me. I worked with everybody. It was a lot of effort, but nonetheless, semester came off more or less without a hitch, right? I understand that life happens. If life happens, all I ask that you do is you contact me, right? Within 12 hours of the deadline or due date in question, right? So missed assignment policy. In the unfortunate event that you miss an assignment due date due to serious illness, death in the family, you must notify me via email, by telephone, by message with the departmental office. Heck, come catch me in one of my other classes. You can find them on sale at the beginning of those classes. You know right where I'm going to be. So come tell me either before the date and time in question or within 12 hours of the deadline or due date. Otherwise, I will not be able to offer an extension. Sounds hard. All right, but really, just let me know, and I'm more than willing to work with you. We'll come up with alternate ways that you like. If something really serious happens, we'll come up with alternate ways for you to complete the semester adequately. I'm more than happy to work with you. I understand. God, I understand better than I think most do. Every now and again, the Department of Homeland Security wants a long chat with me and I miss a class, right? So I get it. Things happen, right? Just, I'm willing to work with you if you're willing to work with me. This policy is here because sometimes I have people talking to me in December about assignments that were due in October. And I can't have that because I've already moved on. We've already had sort of an answer assessment key posted, and it's just not fair to other people to have that additional time and all of those additional resources to complete those assignments. Assignment submission. I've got a new policy here that points out that it's your responsibility to ensure that your assignments have been properly uploaded to Moodle. When you submit your assignment, be sure to double check that your upload was successful. If I don't have it, it's not there. I don't know how many times I've had students say, but there must have been some sort of technical difficulty for my upload to Moodle, right? Give yourself time, upload it to Moodle, double check that it's there. If you're really freaked out at the same time as you're uploading to Moodle, email it to me, then you're sure I've got it. It's your responsibility to get this to me. I can't come chasing you. I can't, I don't have to, there are a lot of you. Right. I've got over 100 students this semester and a PhD to finish and twin girls and a bad commute. Right. So just make sure I've got it. Right. That's your responsibility. It's just the same thing that would happen with a job application. Make sure your application is submitted. Email. The point here is, well, first off, use Oakland University email. If you don't have that email account up and running, have that account up and running, because Oakland University likes to own these things. I'm not supposed to even respond to a Gmail, for example, account. Right. Right, Oakland University email. And secondly, I do my best to stay on top of emails. Again, there are a lot of you. I get a lot of them. So sometimes I bulk respond to people. If I get five of the same question, I email everybody in response. Right? I'm not ignoring you. I'm just trying to be efficient. And sometimes I just get swamped. Right? So I'm going to do my best to be on top of these things. The best and most efficient way to catch me is by catching me in person, which is hard for an online class, I understand. So you guys get email preference, but sometimes I lag behind. It's not instant the way you'd like it to be, right? Form content policy, I've already talked about. And then finally, even before you ask, there's no extra credit in this class. It's out of 100. Do your best on that 100. Done that. Moodle's your hotspot. This video has been emailed to you. After that, it's your responsibility to check Moodle to see what's been uploaded in the way of resources for this course. Stay up to date, stay timely. And speaking of up to date, important dates gives you all of your due dates there. And I give you a tentative reading schedule here as well. So week one, hello, syllabus, course policy, overview, general historical introduction to philosophy, pre-Socratic discussion. The discussion part is for my own campus classes. I'll upload you a video so that you get an understanding of where Socrates is coming from. I'm considering this week one, the week of September 9th, which is tomorrow. Because Labor is starting before Labor Day is silly. And then finally, grading scheme. Familiarize yourself with this grading scheme so you don't freak out when I give you an 80 and you're thinking you got a B. This is my letter grade to percentage point conversion chart, and the official letter grade to GPA conversion chart from Oakland University. You can see that the A range runs all the way from 80 to 100. It's accordingly harder to get to 80 or 100. This is just what I grew up with. It makes absolutely no difference. I give you a percentage grade, which I then, at the end of the semester, convert to a letter grade. The letter grade is then converted to GPA, and GPA is all the Office of the Registrar ever sees. So your grade is still your grade. It's just a different sort of arbitrary system for calculating that grade. So please, like I started with, contact me if you have any questions about this material or about the syllabus or about the course at all. The first of the material will be up very shortly. I look forward to an interesting semester, some interesting discussions, and to reading your written work. Have good days, one for each of you.